to both, and then we can start. Yeah, no, first of all, we wanted to thank everyone for coming. Costanz for Professor Gutenke for giving us this platform, Corpus Christi for giving us the account and the support, and everyone who came and participated with such enthusiasm. We didn't really expect that much great feedback when we first announced the series, so the level of response has been incredible, and we're all gonna miss you very much as well, and we're gonna miss this atmosphere a lot. And also, obviously, thank you to the speakers, and thank you to our closing speakers tonight as well, which we're great. We're really grateful that they could be here tonight, even though virtually. I mean, this is like the perks of Zoom, right? So thank you so much to everyone, really. Side note again, just to go through the basics of Zoom conduct, please. Mute yourself if you're not speaking, but please feel free to type in the chat at any time. We'll be taking questions at the end, either through raised hand or if you prefer to type your comment and then we can read it out loud, or you can come in and ask a question. That would be great too. And as I said before, if you're gonna miss this, we have a conference coming up, so please keep an eye open for that. We'll be sending the call for papers again with a closing emails tomorrow. So thank you again, and thank you for being here for this closing event. And I'm gonna leave it over to Marcus now to introduce our amazing speakers tonight.
Thank you, Eleonora. It's my sincere pleasure to introduce our two speakers for this evening. Mark Payne is a professor of classics and chair of comparative literature at the University of Chicago, and is also on the committee for the Social Thought Program. Within Greek and Roman literature, he has worked on lyric and didactic poetry, comedy, and Hellenistic poetry. More broadly, he is interested in animal and plant studies, primitivism, ancient and modern, and most recently, speculative fiction. He has published four books, Theocritus and the Invention of Fiction, 2007, The Animal Part, Human and Other Animals in the Poetic Imagination, 2010, which was the winner of the 2011 Warren Brooks Award for Outstanding Literary Criticism, Hontology, Depressive Anthropology and the Shame of Life in 2018, and Flowers of Time on Post-Apocalyptic Fiction in 2020. He has also written recently a foreword to poet Stephanie Burt after Callimachus for the Lockett Poetry in Translation series. And Stephanie Burt is a professor of English at Harvard. She is also a poet and literary critic. Selected works include Advice from the Lights in 2017, The Poem Is You, 60 Contemporary American Poems and How to Read Them, 2016, and Belmont Poems, 2013. The New York Times called Burt one of the most influential poetry critics of her generation. And the recipient of the 2016 Guggenheim Fellowship, her writing has appeared in the New York Times Book Review, the London Review of Books, the Times Literary Supplement, The Believer, and the Boston Review. Her collection, After Callimachus, was released in April of this year. Thank you to you both.
Thank you. Thank you, Marcus, and thank you, Eleanor, for having us, and thanks to everyone for coming. This is the book. I hope you can all see it. I encourage you all to purchase a copy of your own. As I say in the introduction, I think it's one of the great poetic translations in English, and I don't say that lightly. I think Callimachus is a poet who, waited a very, very long time to find his sort of modern poet translator, but has now found that person in Stephanie. But as I said to Marcus Nella, I'll try to say some things, just very briefly before handing things over to Stephanie, that are perhaps a bit more specific to, this particular occasion on which we're talking about this translation. So I'm just gonna say three things that I really like about Stephanie's translations in the context of this particular event. So the first is what I'm going to call the sort of Frank O'Hara-ishness of the translation. By which I mean, you know, capturing a certain kind of tone of sort of chattiness and, you know, chattiness as it reveals the way in which, you know, being historical is sort of constituted, not, you know, not by sort of, you know, big ideas, not the sort of Antigone version of being historical, but, you know, momentary passions, right? The sort of momentary passions that kind of constitute being historical for any of us at, any given time. And, you know, I think that capturing that feeds into one of the things that, you know, I think is really great about this translation, which is its inventiveness and its playfulness. That if you want to capture that aspect of being historical, you have to be inventive, you have to be creative about finding equivalents. And, you know, I think it's hard pressed to find a translation by anybody that that's more accomplished and more, you know, more creative, more inventive, more charming in that way than, Stephanie. The second thing, you know, which I think is sort of, you know, related to that, is a, you know, a quality of sort of empathy, a kind of quality of sort of feeling into Callimachus's work. You know, one of the poems that I talk about specifically in the introduction is Stephanie's translation of a fragment of the Heckley, you know, which has to do with the kind of first growth of a, you know, of a young person's beard, right? And, you know, that's something that, you know, all of us who work in classical studies, we all are aware of that as kind of marking a particular sort of moment in the sort of, you know, evolution, development, efflorescence of sexual being. But I think, you know, to see what Stephanie does with that in terms of sort of, you know, feeling her way into, you know, what might look like just a kind of moment of, you know, tangency, perhaps. I think, you know, that will sort of take you a long way into understanding, I think, what's so great about these translations. And then, you know, it's a sort of third point would be, you know, sort of building on that kind of empathy. I mean, just to think about, you know, think about the ways in which Stephanie handles the longer poems by Callimachus. I mean, when I first met Stephanie, she'd already been working on the epigrams for a long time. And, you know, to the extent that I had any sort of, you know, input in this book or, helped it come into being, it was just a suggestion. Yeah, well, why don't you also think about some of these amazing long poems, right? The hymns, the fragments of the Heckley, the fragments of the Aetia. And I think, you know, one of the translations that I like very much in this book is Stephanie's translation of hymn 5, right? And one of the moments where I think you can see Stephanie's sort of empathetic approach is in, you know, the response of Tiresias's mother to Tiresias's blinding at the hands of, Athena, and, you know, the way in which Stephanie kind of handles that dialogue, where, you know, you see both the kind of mythological event itself, and you also kind of see the way in which Stephanie is feeling herself, feeling her way into Callimachus's feeling of himself into that book, right? Into that moment, right? Into that story. You know, you get a very strong sense, I think, from Stephanie's translation of that poem, of like what it was like for a Hellenistic poet and Callimachus in particular to, you know, turn to the sort of mythological material of the past and kind of find their way into it for their own concerns, right? Not in a kind of, you know, secondary kind of belated way, but as a source of, you know, stories that were, you know, eminently kind of restageable, right? For the kinds of passions that sort of animate the ordinary life that is so charmingly staged in the rest of Callimachus's poetic work. So I think that that's I'll leave it there, and then I'll you know, I'll turn it over to Stephanie. I don't know if you have things you want to say about the translation, if you just want to, you know, read some of your, you know, favorites, however you want to do it.
I don't even know what I want to do. I mean, what working writer does not want to be read like that? Like, what translator does not want to hear from an actual world expert in the topic that she's gotten that far into the material? So I'm a little bit floored, and I hope you're right, and I hope that you're not the only person who sees them this way. I hope, things that Mark didn't mention include that one of the reasons I went back to Callimachus after, you know, I got interested in Callimachus in the late 90s, and did, you know, a double handful of translations and published some of them. And then just walked away and did other things. And I came across an article of Mark's that's probably more than 10 years old. That was about Callimachus and the idea of childhood. This very technically sophisticated poet as someone whose attitude toward the world was queer and childlike. I think I saw this when it was a working paper that was going around the Chicago Poetics Group. And I saw that paper and it made me realize that there was more I could do with Callimachus, and it helped me understand why this was a poet I had been drawn to earlier in my life. And the more Callimachus I did, the more encouragement God, especially from Mark and from Rosanna Warren at Chicago. So this, even more than most poetry, feels like a group effort or like an unacknowledged collaboration. This whole book feels like a collaboration not only with somebody who died in Alexandria, or probably in Alexandria quite a long time ago, but with several people who are alive. Most of, you know, at least one of whom is in the room with us right now, and all of whom have better Greek than I do. I have enough Greek to do this and to read scholarly articles about Callimachus, but not enough to, you wouldn't want to make me a reviewer on a scholarly piece about Callimachus, but you would want to text me to say that it was out, if that distinction makes sense. I don't really know what I'm doing, and I don't belong in a classics department, but I hope that I belong in a Queer in the Classical seminar, and it's just a tremendous honor to be here. And I think what I'm supposed to do now is read from the book until someone stops me. Which is what we did last time we did something like this, which was a bookstore event, where with a less informed audience, but a very wonderful, enthusiastic one. That said, it is December 10th or 11th if you're in New Zealand or Australia. And is that true? Yeah, that's true. If you're over there, thank you for getting up so early. And everybody's got Zoom fatigue, and I don't know how much passive somebody reading at you on a screen people want in their lives right now. So I'm going to read some poems, and then if people have already got questions or requests, and I do take requests if anybody besides Marcus and Marcus and Eleonora have read the book, I will take requests either for subjects or for individual works if they're in there. I am happy to intermingle the Q&A with more readings, and I think that is more fun for me than just I'm going to read at you until everybody's eyeballs fall out. But you know, I love the originals, and I'm pretty happy with the translations that I did, as much as a translator can ever be happy with her work. The book is arranged with a bunch of short poems and fragments, and then a long poem, one of the hymns, which are the only long poems that survive complete, and then some more short poems, and then a hymn, and then some more short poems, and then a hymn. And the short poems are very roughly grouped by subject, so that they, the first one is sex and erotic love, and the second one is politics, and the next to the last one is death. So we're gonna start with sex. Am I talking too much, or is this the kind of thing we want? I've been to poetry readings where the poet didn't talk at all, and it was really disturbing. And I've been to poetry readings where the poet talked a lot, and depending on the nature of the event, it was either welcome or like those when you go to a rock concert and the singer just talks and people shout, play music. Should I talk more about the queerness? We haven't talked about queer identity very much.
At some point, it would be, great to talk about what you said, like, not so long, about the sort of, about going back to the poems and, like, the relationship between sort of, you know, the kind of queerness and child mind.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, that part of what you did with the translations, as you know, I think is amazing. So, yeah. I don't know if you want to sort of talk about it up front or read a, you know, read something that you think kind of captures it and then talk
about
it.
How about both? I'll because the other thing about the sex poems is that they're fun. And here comes an awesome fifth grader who I think is a cat. Are you a cat right now? Hey. Hey, Cooper, do you want to say hi to a whole lot of people mostly in and around Oxford University who study queer things or Greek and Latin or both of them? And my friend Mark is here. This is Mark. This is Cooper, who is a cat right now.
Yeah, hi, Cooper.
Hi. Hi. Speaking of child mind, Cooper doesn't have the kind of self-reproach that you see in Callimachus, but Cooper absolutely has the creativity and the syncretism. Cooper puts together things that don't normally go together and rewrites the stories of the past for their own purposes. Honey, are you hungry? Did you have your pizza and your apple? Okay, I'm actually at work right now. You're super cuddly and wonderful. It's kind of a poetry thing. Okay, Ashwin's gonna come hang out with you Friday. He's not free today. What a great kid. I have two cats and two kids, and you're gonna see at most one cat and one kid, because the others are shy. In any case, some of you are probably familiar with the argument, which you can find in the more accessible precincts of modern and more optimistic precincts of modern queer theory. Catherine von Stockton does it. Jack Halberstam does it in a way that seems a little glib, but is not wrong. The idea that the goals that we are given as the goals of adulthood are satisfying for some people, but are really a whole lot of extremely inappropriate and confining and cisnormative and heteronormative and also mononormative pieces of garbage that you have to dodge on your way to a satisfying queer existence in the world. And if you try to, fight back against all of that garbage, it looks like trying to remain a child. And if you stay attached to the unfixedness and the kinds of permissions and forgiveness that come in, certainly in modern bourgeois society and in some parts of ancient society, some of the time, that come with childhood, it looks like resistance to I'm going to use an ugly portmanteau word, cis-mono-heteronormativity. I assume everybody in this space knows what cis-normativity is. Do we know what mononormativity is? Do we not? Should I define it? Okay.
Go for it. Yeah.
Yeah, Meryl's correct. Heteronormativity is the assumption or the requirement that everyone is or should be straight. Cisnormativity is the assumption or the requirement that everyone is or should be cisgender. And mononormativity is the assumption that everyone is or should be seriously erotically involved with one and only one person at a time. So it involves the erasure of ace and aromantic people, and it also involves the erasure or the punishing of people who have more than one committed erotic partner. So there's a whole lot of queer positivity that is in this version of Callimachus, and there are also in-jokes for trans people. And there's also a good deal of fairly, it's clear if you're looking for it, at least, polyamory stuff. Language and ideas about the validity of people who have more than one romantic and erotic commitment. And that's a lot more explicit in these English poems, which mostly are not accurate translations and don't claim to be, than in the originals. But the way that the originals treat erotic rivalry and erotic jealousy and erotic attraction and erotic disappointment seem to me to leave a ton of room for that. And also we just need 30 years ago, if you were a guy who was mostly attracted to guys or a woman who was mostly attracted to women, you could look at the available set of resources in English and say, where are the gay and lesbian love poems? They were there, but they were coded and there weren't enough. And there's never enough of something you want, right? Like, I can't really eat enough persimmons. These are delicious. But there's a lot of it now, but we don't really have a canon of poly love poetry. And it would be nice if Callimachus could provide it. We do have a canon of poetry of erotic jealousy. And Callimachus treats erotic jealousy as a matter of inevitable amusement and something to describe and work around and to reconcile with other emotions. More often than he treats it in a way that we might associate, for example, with Catullus, as something that will burn you up forever inside and destroy you. The fact that there is, and I know that Catullus loved Callimachus and translated himself, but I think it's not a coincidence that we live in a strongly cisnormative and mononormative society, even if it's less heteronormative than it used to be, and that there's a lot of Catullus in English and not a whole lot of Callimachus. And yeah. the openness and the fluidity with which Callimachus treats erotic poetry, including the poetry of erotic failure and disappointment.
Interesting, Stefan, if you don't mind me. One of the questions, as you know, that intrigued me was, as I said in the introduction, why has it taken this long for a poet as important as Callimachus, right? Historically important as Callimachus, to find their translator, right? I thought about various explanations for that, but, thinking about it as something that's actually sort of there and kind of embedded kind of in the, even if coded in the sort of affective structure of the poems, that it's taken this long, right, for someone to be able to feel their way into them, to feel like, okay, I can do this from the inside out. I think that's really helpful. And not just thinking about it at the level of, to do with style or historical contingency or something like that, right?
Mm-hmm. And hang on. There's a side conversation in the chat that, yeah. I just realized, like this, I didn't realize this before, and I wouldn't have realized it if I weren't supervising a really promising undergraduate paper on 19th century Oxford Hellenism and sort of English elite homophile stuff. When you ask why someone didn't get the applause that you feel they deserve, one of the things you can ask is, was there something about that work that put people off? But the other thing you can ask is, was there just not a constituency? Because there's two massive constituencies for the verse of classical antiquity brought into modern non-specialist contexts from much of the 19th to 20th centuries, right? One of them is the imperial and post-imperial contexts for Virgil, right? And for, to some extent, for Homer. And the poets of boarding schools, the poet who you get inducted into a national culture by translating, right? And Callimachus doesn't do that. I should have said three, not two. One of them is Renaissance authors like Shakespeare and Marlowe already love this, so we need to get down with it in order to be an English department, which is why no one forgets about Ovid.
Right.
And one of them is cis men who are really into other men and want high prestige ways of talking about that, especially high prestige ways that can be mapped onto the very sort of non-modern sort of Erastes or Romanos, like Theocritus stuff, right? The Oxford Hellenism model of what we now call queerness, and what we now call men who love men. Callimachus doesn't really give you much of that either. If you go looking for it, you can find a little bit of it. But the consistent one shepherd loves another who's clearly younger and super cute and is pining for 2,000 lines, and then they have a flute contest. Like, that stuff's great, but Callimachus is not where you go for that. It's much easier to think about the variety of erotic failures and successes and disappointments and comedy and variety in Callimachus in the modern context of there are 2 million ways to be queer and all of them resist heteronormativity. And so it's no wonder that the Oxford Hellenism of the 19th century didn't, Callimachus wasn't their favorite poet either. Most of the people in this conference probably know more about that than me. So, you know, stop me if I'm wrong. Wait, you're literally calling Roz right now? Oh, wow. That's not what I meant. Oh, I'd love to have her pop in. Yeah, and you should invite her to the next one.
I'll see what I can do, but she has a lot of stuff that's going on at the moment. I mean, the UK is mad with trans stuff at the moment.
I have noticed, like, I wish I could do more from over here.
Get us asylum.
What?
Get us asylum.
So I would advise New Zealand or Canada for that right now.
It's probably safer, but I've lived in California for a few years and it's much safer than being here.
Oh no, I'm sure. No, I just mean that we it's going to take a little while to get rid of Trumpism and the immigration bureaucracy.
Right. So apologies for derailing the conversation, folks.
I mean, all of this stuff is in there. And I'm glad you brought it up. Yeah. I'm sorry about anger. Anyway, maybe now I should open with some trans politics stuff. Epigram 34.
Okay.
What?
Do you want to tell me the page, Stephanie, and then I'll do the screen sharing for it.
Oh shit. Let me open a different file then. Sorry.
No, that's all right. I can probably find it this way too. Don't worry.
I'm opening the copy edited file.
Yeah.
Which I think has page numbers.
You know what? I've got it. It's cool.
Okay.
I can just search in.
I'll just do some sex poems and some politics poems and some more poems, and we'll see what we can do.
Okay.
We've been chatting, which is fun, maybe more fun for me. And if you're here for a poetry reading, you deserve one.
Okay. So we're gonna kick off with 34 then, yeah?
Oh, are we? Okay. Okay. Are there any fans of the band Against Me in here? Anyone? Cheryl?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. Oh, this is perfect, yeah. Epigram 34. For the sake of Laura Jane Grace and all the graces, Mona, don't tell me how broke I am. I am quite aware of it. That's almost as rude as telling someone her own dream. As pointless as spelling out pi to 12 decimal places. If you're really worried, you could always buy me some food or find me appropriate work so I could take care of it. And Callimachus is an author who lends himself to in-jokes. He's full of in-jokes. And so I preserved some of his and put in more. Laura Jane Grace is the lead singer for the punk folk band Against Me, who already had quite a successful career singing about destroying capitalism when she came out as a trans woman something like 6 or 8 years ago. And then they made an album and a half of really terrific, very angry songs about trans identity. So Laura Jane Grace is, famous for a niche. And if you are on trans Twitter a lot, one of the things you see constantly is people, often young people, doing Ko-fis and GoFundMes and Patreons to fund their transitions. Because insurance often doesn't cover it the way it should. So that's what that poem's about. Mark, I'm gonna unview your screen.
Sure.
We can keep your screen up. And I will read maybe some more. Oh, you know what? You love the proem to Atia Book One so much that I should probably read that.
Shit.
Yeah. Okay, so this is the beginning of the Atia.
Okay, hold on.
So, and it's got some music in jokes and some other in jokes. When you're ready. And this took me forever to get ready. I just kept tinkering with it, which is very meta given what the poem is about. Okay. So reactionaries and radicals complain that I have no proprietary mission, no project that's all mine. Instead, I am like a child flipping pogs or building in Minecraft, although I'm past 40. To them, I say, keep rolling logs for one another, but don't waste my time on your ambition. Marathon runners and shock jocks gain by going as far as they can, but the sublime, the useful, and the beautiful in poetry, Mark, are all inversely correlated with size. Shorter means sweeter. I'll be fine. When first I rated myself as a writer of some sort, wolf-killing, light-bearing Apollo came to me as a ferret. Stay off crowded trains, he said. Never resort to volume where contrast will do. Imitate Sati or young marble giants. The remedy for anomie lies in between the wing slips of the cicada. If I can't be weightless, or glide among twigs, or sate myself on dew, then let my verses live that way, since I feel mired in age, and worse for wear. It might even be that when the muses visit a girl or a schoolboy, they intend to stay, or else to come back, even after the poet goes gray. That was so much fun to work on, and that directly comes out of Mark's work. Callimachus is connecting his well-known preference for the highly worked and the apparently unambitious and the small scale and the nearly ornamental to his interest in childhood and in the immature. And he's refusing to do the Virgilian thing of showing that you're a very important and properly masculine grown-up by writing a national epic. Which is part of his, I believe, blown out of proportion quarrel with Apollonius of Rhodes, that they actually got along, but their followers didn't. And they believe they were teasing each other more than actually hating each other. But there's a tradition, one of the traditions about him that's probably wrong, is that they hated each other because Apollonius of Rhodes said, you know, why don't you write an epic? You were unmanly for not writing an epic. More poems read aloud? Yeah? Okay. I promised you sex poems. And
that's right. We won't go anywhere till we hear them.
We won't. I also genuinely, honestly need to know if there are X-Men fans in the audience, because if there are serious X-Men fans in here, I'll read some of the poems that have X-Men in jokes, and if there aren't, I will not. You know, Callimachus, if it works, you didn't notice the X-Men references unless you got them and liked them. And I'm going to try to read some of the lighter ones. Callimachus is a great poet of erotic disappointment and of not getting what you want. But he's also pretty good at, you know, not giving up. Can we do epigram 43?
Sure.
Okay. Please tell me there are Star Trek fans in here. Okay. Okay, good. Okay. Epigram 43. We gotta wait. It's easier to explain if we use Mr. Spock. Had it been my decision to develop a crush on you, you may indeed have objected. It is most illogical. It might indeed offend. And yet, if neurobiology will require me to experience this emotion, and moreover, to communicate it, well, it's not like we can turn back the relevant clock. It's not like I stood in your right of way at midnight and threw pebbles at your window. All I did was leave a note on your door. I have been and always shall be your friend. People like it. Thank you. Yeah. I read and write fan fiction pretty regularly, although I don't read a lot of Star Trek fan fiction. It's a large fandom that's I'm still learning canon. But there is a way in which there is an overlap between creating fan works and creating these poems that is larger and deeper and more fun than the overlap between creating fan works and writing publishable poetry in general.
If I can sort of jump in again, I mean, I remember teaching classes on Hellenistic poetry here at the university, and you know, I remember a student asking, you know, is it okay if I write my paper on like sort of Hellenistic poetry and fan fiction, because like that's what a lot of this looks like to me. And I was like, yeah, totally, 100%, because I think that is what it's like. And I, you know, I've tried to sort of use that model in thinking about it, and trying to sort of combine it with, you know, a paper by somebody else, Stephanie, who I know you love very much, and that's Ursula Le Guin. I mean, Ursula Le Guin's carrier bag theory of fiction, right? I mean, it's like, if you can kind of put those two together, right? And like, you know, what's the thing in this poem that you're reading, right, that's kind of waiting to be retold from another perspective? And like, you know, what are you going to bring to that? I mean, Lavinia is obviously one of the, you know, world's great examples of that. But like, it's such a useful way of just of kind of going through that kind of, you know, empathic sort of feeling in process, right? So I wonder what makes you, what do you write fan fiction of? Like, I mean, how do you kind of find your way into it? I mean, with Ursula Le Guin, you feel like sometimes it's a bit kind of annoyance, right, is the trigger. I mean, she says
that. Yeah. Henry Jenkins, who is one of the academic theorists of fan fiction, who people who work in that field like, what is his phrase? He talks about how being a fan involves being fascinated and frustrated. That's the phrase, fascinated and frustrated with canon.
Mm.
I should probably read a few more poems, and then I hope there's questions. Let's see. Those are sad. That one's about being old and experiencing lust. This one's fun. This one is as modern as I can make it. And it's it involves poly problems. It is epigram 27.
Okay.
I'm trying to read some of the lighter ones, the ones that are more fun for me to read aloud. I can get to some of the there's memorial poetry. There's quite heavy material in here. If people want that, but this is, I did promise a sex poem, that has some fairly, that is also explicitly anti-mononormative. And this is one of them, epigram 27. Once they decided to make a home together, Cal told Ione that he would never consider anybody else as his regular lover. All of us knew he was bi, but he said he would never place any guy or any woman above her. Now it's as if he were poisoned or else on fire, throwing off sparks left and right for a brand new crush who happens to be non-binary. As for Ione, all his friends now have to push ourselves to see or even to think about her. Poor girl, who last week thought she was his primary. And if that is language that is new to anyone, if you have multiple partners, but one of them is more important or more serious than the rest of them, that is your primary. Poor girl. Maybe one or two more poems and then questions. My favorite is when people just ask questions and then we can alternate questions and readings. Lena, thank you. I'm entirely serious about wanting to know if there are any X-Men fans in here. Usually there's like, you know, zero or two. It's a small fandom.
We've had a lot of positive replies in the chat, I think.
Oh, so. I thought it was the Star Trek stuff. Okay.
No, I think okay. It was the X-Men too, yeah.
Okay, yeah, okay. And of the comics, right? Not just the movies. Okay, then we'll do this one. You know what? Let's do this one. Oh dear, sorry. Okay. So this is a poem that I think is one of the ones that Mark encouraged me to translate. It's A-tier fragment 178. If you're using the index, Our People Have Our Own Holidays, the Greek is Eos Odipiphoges. I hope it's got a lot of layers, and it is about living in and through fandom. Okay. So this is A-tier fragment 178. Our people have our own holidays, which we observe when traveling. It was on Gray's Day that I first met Lynn, who used another name then. She had come to Egypt for some sort of financial reason. I never asked for details. We hadn't met, but as the saying goes, we were strangers in Egypt. If you don't know, I literally live in Egypt. She ended up staying at my place to avoid one of those horrific white-collar workplace parties where all the dudes get smashed. You know the type. A friend of a friend called and told me she needed a place to crash, stat. So we had a few glasses of wine on my couch, and I think she was afraid I'd come on to her, which I did not want to do. Seriously, you don't do that to somebody who has no place to go. Really, dudes. Instead, I asked her about her own sacred days. Why do your people worship the Cyclops, for example, and mourn his epic death one day each year? And then she told me the story. You would not believe how long it took. When she was all done, it was practically dawn. I remember saying, "You're lucky. You can find some of your people wherever you go." And she said, "I guess, but I think you're lucky if you never board an airplane. As for me, I see myself in kittiwakes and turns. If I feel at home anywhere, it's over water, practically soothed by jet engines, trying to get some sleep by counting the curves and the waves." Now I feel like I should do the other Cyclops poem. Mark?
Sure.
Okay. Let me get a number for that. This is so much fun. I hope it's here we go. It is epigram 26. And that is Nathan's best friend. Nathan is the one you're not gonna see in ninth grade. Talk amongst yourselves for a minute.
Should we use this moment to have a 5-minute break?
Oh, sure. And then I'll do some more reading. Yeah. That sounds great. And Fantastic.
Okay, cool. Let's take our 5-minute break and let's come back here at around kind of 6:07 in the UK and GMT, or whatever it means to have 5 minutes and whatever kind of time zone or temporality that you are a part of right now. See you all back here in a bit, folks.
And Kai Dipper, it's kind of a long one. Are you up for that, or?
Oh, yeah. Should I read the little one with the action figure and then read that one?
Sure. Whatever you want.
If anything, excessively obliging. What is?
So that was right. Epigram, say, yeah. Firstly, then epigram 26. Yeah, that's.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, all right.
Hang on. Do we wish people to come back? I'm not sure what the people back, Marcus.
Hi, hi. I think we're good. I think we look like we have most people back. I mean, the traditional like welcome back from the break. So, in lieu of that, apologies.
Okay.
Whenever you're coming back to.
Okay. Oh, Cheryl Morgan is following me. That's cool. Epigram 26. I am a superhero with mask, gloves, and boots on. An action figure who comes with a burger and fries. You can bend my elbows and knees or pretend force beams come out of my ruby-tinted eyes. Once the station or corner of rug I defend would have been a GI's or a straight-shooting sheriff's, but I was made for a nation where guns are neither a toy nor a surprise. And some of you may know the original is about a protective statue that in a certain town is always placed before doors as a figure of a standing soldier or military figure, where normally this kind of statue is on horseback. And the reason is because this town has very negative associations with cavalry, having been, I think, besieged by horse riders earlier. And yeah, that was interesting. Was that me?
No, that was me.
Okay,
was me.
We asked Nobody for, asked. Okay, Sadippy? Let me look for that one. Okay, yeah. Yeah, I was really worried about putting this one early in the book, but it's really fun, and it's, for me, a good example of how when you of how when you make something make the potential trans content somewhere when you change it from subtext to text, you can change everything. Should I read the whole thing? Mark, you were talking up the long poems.
Sure.
Okay.
As much as you like. I mean, we got a request, that's why I mentioned it.
Okay, sure. Sure. And the requester is still around?
I believe so.
The requester is Daniel? Is Daniel still here? Okay. Here you go. So this is from the Aetia, which, as some of you know and some of you don't, is a collection of related stories about the origins of things, of either names for things or of the things themselves. And the stories are all over the place, but they're connected because they are origin stories. And I kind of, some of the poems in here are kind of Frankensteined from fragments that might be unrelated, but in this case, I believe that we know all these fragments belong to the same story. They're just cataloged as separate fragments because there's missing stuff in between, which is just as well. This is a story with a happy ending. If you met Aaron early enough in his life, you might have wondered who taught him the arts of conversation. He who could put anyone, adult or child or in between, at ease, yet got tongue-tied when he brought up Sidippi. He who wanted nothing more than to see her, in fact, to spend the rest of his life beside her so that the world would see him as her husband. They had a lot in common. The two of them met at Delos at the big sacrifice. He came all the way from Eulis. They would talk about how both of their mothers were engineers, how both had family in the islands, about the races outdoors, about where to stand to avoid the crowds at the temple. Avoiding crowds is always a Callimachus thing. But other sons' mothers regarded her as the prize, bringing bride gifts, bringing whole oxen, although in her own eyes she was far too young. Nobody else stood out in the morning dances. Nobody else reminded so many observers of the rose-gold dawn. He stood out too, but frankly it made him uncomfortable. More than uncomfortable. You might have heard he spelled his name differently then. People singled him out at school and at parties back home. He liked the attention, but only at first. He got really into archery. And all of us thought he just liked spending time in the sun. We can talk about archery in this book if you want. In fact, he was praying to Artemis, to the thin moon he observed after dawn and right before sundown, because it's bow-shaped, praying she might see him, that Cydippe might see him the way he so badly wanted to be seen. That the proverbial archer might strike her too, not Artemis nor Apollo, the other one. That it might hurt just a little. That they could talk about his prayers. And that's just what happened. I think you're brave, she said. I don't think you deserve to be afraid. Bad news. By then, her mother had arranged, of course, for Cydippe to marry someone else. Good news, our heroes got to spend the night together first, because the cult of Hera insists, I'm going to get into trouble, serious trouble, if I go into detail here. Just know the families in Hera's cult insist on this kind of bridal evening for the education of daughters who will then make better wives. Next morning, the families led two oxen to the pool where they would see the point of the blade that would tear their hearts out that night. That's part of the Hera cult too, but that afternoon Cydippe had a fit. A literal fit, the kind that makes people behave like wild goats, flailing and barking. They thought she was going to die and canceled the ritual, and then she got better. And then the ceremony was back on, at which point she came down with a boiling fever, which lasted several months, as if she had worked for it. And then she could breathe again, so they set the wedding for a third date, and then she came down with a chill. More than a chill, a frost fever, so her very lips and eyes seemed to congeal, as if she could not remain for long in this cold world. Cat break. Hi. He usually likes this, and then he goes away and waits. Snowbar, hey. This is a lot of people who study queer content in classical antiquity. They're awesome. You're awesome, too. You're very mysterious. Okay, bye. At this point, Cydippe's father knew enough to pray to Apollo, who came to him that night. My sister will not permit this marriage, said the god. She was right there in her shrine, though you did not see. At the festival in Delos, when your child swore that Aaron and nobody else would be her husband. Yes, her husband. And now, if you care for your daughter, you'll listen to me. For one thing, she swore an oath, and she's bound to keep it, and my sister agrees. The god reached over his shoulder, grasping one of his sun-bright arrows. Artemis, too, can shoot such radiant arrows with perfect aim, though hers look more like moonlight. For another, the sun god went on, if you let her marry Aaron, you will not blend lead with silver, but rather mix your silver with his gold. You know your own stock. He comes from mountain climbers and from wind tamers. His family taught their island to catch quail in wind-borne nets. So Aaron came back to Naxos And the girls whom Artemis befriended said their hymns, including the marriage hymn, over both of them. And Aaron, for all you love to hunt and sprint and shoot, I know you would not have traded that night for anything. Neither the sandals of Aphra, so fast she covered a whole field of wheat by running across the crests of the wheat ears, nor everything Midas owns. For people are not possessions. Lovers are not possessions, neither each other's nor their families. If you have known love, you should know that, especially if you serve Artemis, whose brother told the truth. Cydippe's family still lives, with many children, up at Aulis. Their story came down to us in Zeno's collection, the one with the island's tales. That was really fun. And, you know, that was just really fun to read and fun to write, and I've rarely read it aloud, and thank you. I can do some more reading at you. I can also answer more questions, and I can take more requests.
Thank you so much. That was so wonderful. I especially loved this one. Thank you. I think we have another request in the chat, and maybe we can switch to a moment of requests / questions. So if people want to raise their hands,
yeah, or like working close, just the feeling of you know, being read at all is so rare and valuable. You said there was another request in the chat, or there wasn't?
Yeah, it was coming back to that. It was Epigram 30.
Epigram 30, okay. Mark, can you do the honors?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Yeah. If there are no more requests, I do want to talk about the role of Artemis in this book a little bit. If there's a pause while we still have time to be together. But my first choice is to read things people actually want to hear. Oh, this one. This is one of the first ones I did. I did this one 20 years ago. Because I am old. Epigram 30. Bunting I like, but not Olson or Bernstein or Pound. I'm tired of flashy long poems that mean whatever anyone wants them to mean. I'm also tired of crowds. Hate the Met as I hate Times Square, and won't see movies everyone else has seen. As for you, Lucanius, I wanted to get to know you. Then I heard how many others have known you, and how well. Tomorrow, in fact, I suspect you'll show yet another young man why he's just the one for you, and how you can tell. Note that the problem there isn't the promiscuity, it's the dishonesty. And there's absolutely a way to read Callimachus that I choose not to take, but that is there in the originals, that makes him the worst kind of snob, that makes him absolutely someone who only offers caviar and speaks to a tiny audience and doesn't want more attention because he doesn't like crowds. That's not what I take from him. But you can, it's how he's been seen by others occasionally. This is also a fight or an argument between several different ways of reading the American poet James Merrill, whom I also love and who's full of in-jokes and super belated and technical and can be read either as welcoming or as off-putting, depending on who you are when you come to him. So yeah, Artemis. I don't want to read the whole hymn to Artemis, but I'll read a short Artemis poem, and then talk about what she's doing and my sense of who she is and what her cult can mean in modernity really changed while I was writing this. Can I maybe read Tosman Ethi Tas Dathar? It's the poem that begins "What the?" It's another part of the Aetia, the one with the garlic. It's HEA Book 1, Fragment 31, and a couple of others.
Yep.
Okay.
There. Yep. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. I haven't, like, embarrassed myself yet, have I? Done anything? Okay. There we go. Yeah. What the? Why does the statue of Artemis, whom I revere, have a clove of garlic tied to her left ear? And why do the temple tenders place a shallow mortar for garlic over her fine short hair? Does this sort of thing have any basis in myth? It does. I keep back nothing for reasons of tact, nothing that I consider beautiful. The goddess herself once chose this crown or halo. When the Epirians attacked this town, they tried to mock, desecrate, and defile her manless status by smearing her head with garlic. The idea was that she had not truly rejected marriage, but rather stank so bad no man could want her. What girl hasn't heard and heard again that if we work too hard, no man will date us? The citizens drove the Epirians into the sea. Pounded raw garlic means a campfire, a meal for a hunter, and for the friends of a hunter. The goddess has never cared to pair off with men, not now, and not in any former age. But the regional cuisine now emphasizes garlic and fascomilo, also known as sage. So, part of the wisdom of Artemis. And I think this is in the Artemis cult in, you know, in classical antiquity, is finding ways to live, finding ways to be a child and ways to be an adult that center the experiences of non-men in a binary gender system, that is the experiences of women. In a modern gender system, it is non-men. And also in some cases, the experiences of non-cis men, the experience of anybody who is living or deserves a chance to live outside of the system of patriarchal requirements. And she's also someone who's not really super into following rules or making entire societies follow rules. There are rules about how to treat her and rules for what you can do if you're in her cult. But she's not someone who is in charge of other gods, as far as I know. I think there's a lot of that. So she's also to some extent about independence. And of course she's about bows and hunting without being about going to medical school and becoming, or about becoming very famous, right? And Apollo does bows and hunting, but also med school and fame. Lena, yes, I would like that. I would like to have her be about non-hierarchical communities. It's not as if she lowers herself to the level of her worshippers. If anybody does that, it's Dionysus, who doesn't interest me personally as much. He didn't even do that either, really. It's sort of all crocs who could throw a party. But I would like to make Artemis a patron for non-hierarchical as well as for anti-patriarchal communities, even though that takes some work. But you know, you can do it if you're adapting rather than trying to do a completely accurate translation. You can do it, and it's fun, and it makes her more like a superhero than some of the other Olympians are, and it makes her actually admirable. I say this to my kids who, you know, read various prose versions of classical stories in translation. And they say, yeah, but, you know, she does tend to cause people to be torn apart by animals for, you know, looking at her without meaning to. Yeah, nobody's perfect. But yes. And I found I think allegiance is the correct word, which had been an allegiance to the ideals that are normally represented by Athena when you're in this register. Moving on, as I you know, did more of this book, to the point where I was more interested in the cult of Artemis and in representations of Artemis than I was in Athena, who is very much, who is a patron of Tiresias in Hymn 5, but who is also about officially authorized learning and the building of institutions and sort of the just city.
I think, I mean, it's very sort of explicit. I mean, that coming together of the kind of childhood moment and the kind of refusal of mm-hmm. you know, I mean, the moment when she as a child is with, you know, with Zeus and is like, you know, can I, is it okay if I just not grow up, right? Can mm-hmm. I just, right? I mean, I think that's a moment where those two things really come together in quite an explicit way in Callimachus, where, you know, maybe they're, you know.
Yep. And I didn't have to make that up. That is in the hymn. No,
exactly. Right.
That yeah, is right there.
Right.
She
that's
also,
what I mean. It's sort of like, you, I mean, it's not, it's adaptive only in the sense that, you know, you're kind of feeling your way into what's at stake there. I mean, you know, there's nothing about the story that's made up by you, right? I mean, it's all yeah. like that. I mean.
And of course, Callimachus says he doesn't make anything up either, right? Nothing that is not attested in my sources. And, you know, when I started this project, I didn't really know the hymns. I knew I had absolutely fallen in love with the epigrams and a whole bunch of the other fragments. And when I looked at the hymns, I was like, I hope I like these, but it's work. And what I found mostly was independent confirmation for hypotheses that I had about the reason I liked this poet so much.
Right.
Bath of Athena, Tiresias origin story, and the hymn to Artemis, most of all. But you know, the hymn to even others too. I think I got something out of the hymn to Zeus.
Yeah, well, I was going to say, I mean, is there anything that you found that you didn't like, or anything that you were like, I, you know, want to push back or put that back in the
book? So the hymn to Apollo, I only translated the kind of coda to it, which is very famous. I couldn't make the rest of it interesting. And the hymn to Delos, just, I don't even remember if we left that in the book, but all that material about the way that Leo looks for refuge. It's very long and I just couldn't make it work.
Yeah.
Is it hymn two? No. It's hymn four that I just gave up on. I just couldn't make it work.
Right.
There were a lot of places where I had to make choices about how much to adapt, and I'm happy with adapting a lot sometimes and a little at other times. Oh, the one that Catullus translates, there are a couple that I just couldn't make work that are shorter ones. That are mostly poems of most of those were poems of homage to a person, and they couldn't make the homage to that person work for me. The more I got to play with ideas about Artemis, the more I like doing that. Are there more questions? Should I read one more poem? Are we beyond our allotted set of moments?
I was just thinking as we come up to 6:30, that we might try and do two things at once, if that's okay. And that's firstly to do a collective thank you, because I know some people have to head off. But also, if you're available to stick around for 15 more minutes, I think we have kind of someone wants to ask a question in the chat, and we could also switch to a mode where people can put their hands up if they feel comfortable as well. That's okay.